I can feel the pressure. I'm trying just to kind of control it.
For the past 9 months, the feeling of one band who've been trying to top their multi-platinum selling debut.
We'll all be disappointed if it doesn't work, and we'll have to figure out where to go from there.
Face the Music tracked their progress as they got ready to release what many people call the difficult second album.
They've had about 7 or 8 years to write the first one, and then a year later they have to do a second album, and it's incredibly difficult.
It's not a business where you can get by selling a few records and then keep a record deal and continue to come out to LA and sit in swimming pools all day.
In 2006, The Feeling released their debut album, 12 Stops and Home. It spawned 5 singles, including the top 10 hits Soul, Fill My Little World and Never Be Lonely. They went on to become the most played band on UK radio, picked up a Brit nomination and walked away with an Ivor Novello Award for Songwriters of the Year.
There's a lot of bands now that sound like The Feeling. They've kind of opened the doors, that were the godfathers of that style of music. And now all these bands have come in the slipstream, so it's important that when we come back with a bang.
The boys spent almost 2 years promoting the first album, and just 2 weeks after they returned from the American leg of the tour, the 5 members, Dan, Richard, Paul, and brothers Kieran and Kevin Jeremiah, went into hiding in the Wiltshire countryside to begin work on the follow-up.
So it's 7 o'clock on, Thursday, I think. I'm editing, just been recording guitar parts with Dan. Look at that mess.
Doing pretty well. You know, sounds all right. Could be a hit.
The first record we made was in the Jeremiah family shed, nobody telling us to be quiet. It was just us. And we wanted the same to happen for this record, but there's no way we were going to go back to the shed because it was stinky. So we ended up in this great big mansion.
This is Bradley House. We've been living in here for a while, making our second album. It's owned by the Duke of Somerset, and he let us use it, which is nice.
We get lawnmowers and sheep and birds singing and all that kind of thing, but when it's blended in with the music, you don't really notice it. And in the moments where you might hear a phone ring or you might hear something else, I think it just adds character. It's the sounds of the house we recorded in. Do anything, you're
moving, but you don't do anything. If you want something to sound big, use the smallest amp.
Sometimes someone just comes up with a good line or a little chord sequence or something, and then that can set me off, and then I'll go and write it into a proper song.
It's not like a planet and kind of map it out very well, and I don't do anything in a specific order, so I might have, oh yeah, that's going to be a good chorus. I'll just keep on piecing it together slowly while I'm sitting there, and then the last thing to get finished off is normally the lyric. I'm still writing the second verse, you know, 5 minutes before I put the vocal down. We started off just recording about 4 songs a week. By the end of it, we'd recorded about 20 songs. I mean, it's still at the end of the day, there was probably about 15 that we had to really kind of cut down to 12 for the album.
My favourite track on the album is Without You, which is a song that Dan wrote while we were on tour in America. Winter's come and summer's go. Last time round for all we know. Wonder what the time is in London. As they tear this world apart, step by step it breaks my heart. We were in Virginia doing a show, and on the day of the show, it was the Virginia Tech massacre happened. Which is obviously all over the news, but we were very close by to it, and it was certainly affecting the area we were in. 30 dead and one teenage gunman. I wonder what the time is in London without you.
It got me because I was there and I really experienced that exact moment that he was inspired by, but it's definitely something that we can all relate to, that when something tragic happens when you're away from home, how much it makes you miss home and miss all the people at home and question the fact that, you know, what if you don't see those people again and how awful that would be.
It's the end of July, the recording process has come to an end, and the record company is keen to hear if their money's been well spent.
We have some people coming to visit us today via helicopter, which is very exciting. They're going to come down and we're going to play them some of the new stuff in the new record and see if they like it.
It's going to be really nice to see sort of reactions on the faces of strangers.
I'm not.
Dan's not looking forward to it.
Our little place.
Oh, you're all invaded.
Coming down here, getting all nosy.
If the record company VIPs don't like what they hear, it'll be a major setback. So, what was the verdict?
So that went rather well, actually. They seemed to like it. And we actually played the songs pretty much right. It's the first time we've played them to anyone other than ourselves, so cheers.
But it's not all work, as the band still have some rock star cliches to live out. How else would you expect the Lords of the Manor to travel?
Break, break, Charlie. Charlie, too. I did it for me. I'm not really particularly materialistic or ostentatious, but I would love one of them. I mean, that's not too much to ask, is it?
I'm not going to get one. Apparently, they're quite expensive.
Welcome to California, baby!
The band head off to LA with the recorded tracks to have them fine-tuned by Spike Stent, the king of the mix, who's worked with everyone from Madonna to U2.
Mixing is balancing all the levels so that it sounds as good and exciting and as big as possible. I want you now, I don't
care how, we're both too young to be seen. This is the point at which we put it all together and see how it all turns out really once it's properly mixed. It's the kind of the polishing of it really. You know, bringing out all the colours and all the textures that are in the music and making sure that they're all audible. And there's a lot that goes into that. It's a much more complicated thing than anyone would think, which is why we're in LA. Because you can't just do it with anyone, you have to do it with good people. And Spike is brilliant. He's one of the best.
It sounds a bit like a cross between The Who and Donna Summer. It's a strange kind of thing.
You know what I mean?
Well, more dramatic.
Yeah, more dramatic.
When we were mixing, I thought it was over. It wasn't as straightforward as you'd think. With any kind of music that's kind of crossing over genres, it's really hard to get the production right, really hard to get the mix right particularly. Some people wanted the disco side of it, and some people wanted the more rocky side of it. And it's always a bit of a balance, trying to get the best out of both.
It is probably just the effect. I want a more dramatic effect on them, really.
The guitars have gone up, so it's sounding thicker, but it's less spacious. Just in the chorus, it actually was worse in the first chorus for some reason.
Do you want me to put it back as it was?
He's loving this.
That was a challenge, getting that right. Could have gone either way, but it was worth it.
It's not actually normally like this. Normally it just happens.
I haven't had enough time to have a break from the record in order to come back to it and listen to it and be able to judge it, you know. So you just kind of keep working at it, try and make it sound better, but it's hard to get a real clear idea of how well it's going.
This one here is what we use for talent. That corrects the mistakes. We tried to get it to go further, but
We broke the knob.
Look, this was my favourite control right here. See that? Makeup. Because if you need a little bit more powder, or mascara, or whatever,
just totally, as you can see, we have